Alright guys, who broke the robot?
Hello everyone, I'm a broken robot. In the world of video games, no type of enemy is as loved and hated as the stalking variant. Enemies that you can't quite kill, so you're either forced to run, hide, or a mix of the two to maneuver around these types of enemies. Some fan favorite stalking enemies from video games include Chris Walker from Outlast, the Hunter from Dead Space, or Slenderman from Slender the Arrival. But I think it's safe to say that no video game franchise has given us better examples and variants of the stalking class of video game enemy than the Resident Evil franchise. Throughout the series, going as far back as Resident Evil 1, stalking enemies that the protagonist can't kill have kept gamers white-knuckled and gritting their teeth for over a decade now. Everyone has their favorite, with Lisa Trevor from Resident Evil 1, Nemesis from Resident Evil 3, and the Bakers from Resident Evil 7 being fan favorites. I know this might be a bit of a controversial statement for diehard Resident Evil fans in the audience, but Capcom truly peaked in terms of design, in-game lore, and in-game mechanics when designing the now fan favorite, Mr. X.
That's what you hear it, listen. X gon' give it to ya. Fuck, wait for you to get it on your own. X gon' deliver to ya.
Before we hop into the video, I'd like to give a quick fan shout out. A special thanks to Cosmo Animations for your continued support for the channel. You've left lots of encouraging comments on my videos, and it's people like you that help keep this channel running. There will be a link to his channel down in the description, and I highly suggest any viewers of this video go check him out. Before we can talk about Mr. X in-game, let's quickly run through his backstory and just what the heck this 7-foot-tall, gray-skinned, fedora-wearing bodybuilder is, and where it came from. So like all biomechanical monstrosities in the Resident Evil franchise, look no further than the Umbrella Corporation. While Umbrella researchers and scientists were perfecting the T-virus that would go on to turn the majority of Raccoon City into flesh-eating zombies, the scientists came to a conclusion while designing the bioweapon. While simulations showed that a controlled outbreak of the T-virus could wipe out 90% of a given population, due to genetic irregularities in global genetic makeup, in some simulations as much as 10% of a population could be resistant or immune to the T-virus. Additionally, the degenerative properties of the T-virus meant that the standard zombie would deteriorate over time. While this sometimes ended up with a red crimson or a liquor, which were far more effective bioweapons than the standard zombies, their brain rot and rigor mortis made their lifespans uncertain. To account for this uncertainty, in 1988 the Hunter program began in the Arklay Laboratory, but after difficulties with controlling the bioweapons, in 1989 the Tyrant Project was born. Originally, the Arklay researchers tried using a combination of heavy doses of the T-virus combined with body-altering surgeries, but after numerous failed attempts, the Arklay researchers reached out to the European branch of Umbrella for help in developing the Tyrant. Research by the staff at the Arklay Laboratory determined that in order to experience mutations of the scale they wanted, the test subjects would require certain genes relating to intelligence, which were found to change how the T-virus would mutate a person physically. Such people were projected to be statistically uncommon, at 1 in 10 million. Consequently, the Tyrant Project had to be delayed while a new strain of the T-virus was engineered, which would expand the number of genetically compatible test subjects. After more failed attempts to alter the human body to fit the mold of the T-virus, researchers instead decided to switch to more compatible subjects. The Tyrant Class 001 had ended, and the research for the Tyrant Class 002 had begun. In Resident Evil 1, you as the protagonist encounter a Tyrant in the final battle. While the Tyrant Mark II is nothing to laugh at, its flaws are almost immediately noticeable. For one, a major setback of the Tyrant Mark II was how they were prone to heart attacks. Because of the low amount of viable test subjects, researchers couldn't risk losing subjects to natural causes, and would surgically install a second heart within every Tyrant they made at the Arklay Laboratory. While these Tyrants weren't nearly as modified by surgery as the Mark I's, there were sometimes complications, with some researchers noting that the second heart made an easy weak spot. Additionally, in order to increase the Tyrant Mark II's limb strength, the body's bones were artificially increased. While normally these were controlled growths, it wasn't always predictable, with most Mark II Tyrants having major bone growth in their hands or feet. The final and most notable flaw of the Tyrant was its weakness to heavy weapons. While the Tyrant could take small and medium arms like a champ, heavy machine guns and grenade launchers can stun, disable, or in some rare cases even eliminate the Tyrant Mark II. Also, as seen in Resident Evil 1, a single hit from a rocket launcher has more than enough to kill it. Luckily for researchers, one of Umbrella's European branch's top members, Colonel Sergei Vladimir, turned out to be a perfect match for the desired genes for the Tyrant development, and was immediately transferred to the Raccoon City facility to have his genes studied and cloned for a more streamlined Tyrant project. Thus, the Tyrant Mark III program began, which is where Mr. X comes in. Unlike previous Tyrants, the Mark III Tyrants were far easier to control and better at following direct orders through implanted brain chips. Additionally, the bone growths were more natural, leading to the Mark III Tyrants not being only far stronger than the Mark I or II, but not having to deal with uncontrolled bone growth spurs. Finally, what gave the Mark III Tyrant an edge over previous models was its sheer increase of mental capacity. As seen on numerous times in the Resident Evil Legends and canon timeline, the Tyrant Mark III units can think strategically when engaging in combat, and are also known to use ambush tactics. While not always included, a thick bodysuit and trench coat were often added to the Mark III Tyrant to prevent spontaneous mutations as a response to physical trauma and damage. While these bodysuits were effective in preventing spontaneous mutations, if the bodysuit was heavily damaged or removed, the Mark III Tyrants were observed on multiple occasions to mutate to a similar form of the Mark II, with uncontrolled spontaneous bone growth and swelled blood vessels. While the Tyrant Mark III isn't invincible, myself and others can agree that in-game, he most certainly is. In Resident Evil 2, whether you're playing as Claire or Leon, you'll encounter one of six Tyrants deployed to Raccoon City to carry out various missions. If you're playing as Leon, you'll encounter the Tyrant that's job is to eliminate any surviving police officers or STAR members. In-game, when you first encounter Mr. X, it's apparent that you stand no chance from the start. You'll see Mr. X lift half a helicopter with just one arm. With the average police helicopter weighing around 4,000 pounds, meaning that with just one arm alone, Mr. X can lift about 2,000 to 3,000 pounds. When you're playing Resident Evil 2, you'll find yourself being chased by Mr. X, and while you can temporarily disable him with enough gunfire, this is only temporarily, and you will most likely end up wasting the bulk of your saved ammunition. A key detail about Mr. X that makes him such an intimidating and iconic stalking video game enemy is how you as the player can hear his heavy footsteps from rooms away, not only adding to the tension, but from a gameplay standpoint, giving the player some idea as to how close the hulking beast is. Here are some of my personal strategies for dealing with Mr. X. I don't claim that any of these strategies are official or effective, so your mileage may vary. It's important to know his patterns. Mr. X follows a specific pattern and will relentlessly pursue you once he's activated. Pay attention to his movements and footsteps to anticipate his location. Keep an ear out for his heavy footsteps as they can help you determine if he's nearby, but also make sure to create distance when encountering Mr. X. Your priority should be to create distance between you and him. Back away or run past him to give yourself some breathing room, but remember, he moves slowly so you can't outrun him if needed. If you need a break or to just get away from him, utilize safe rooms. Mr. X cannot enter safe rooms, so take advantage of these areas to plan your next move, heal or collect supplies. You can use various items in the environment to distract Mr. X and divert his attention away from you. Throw objects, shoot nearby walls or surfaces, or use explosions to create noise and lure him away. Utilize alternate routes as well. Explore the game environment to find alternate routes or shortcuts that allow you to avoid Mr. X. Look for paths that can lead to objectives, while bypassing the areas where he might be patrolling. A bit of advice I wish I got before playing Resident Evil 2 was to combine evasion with progress. While it's important to avoid Mr. X, try not to let him hinder your progress entirely. Use your time wisely to complete your objectives or solve puzzles while keeping an eye out for his movements. Timing is crucial in balancing evasion with progress. But most importantly, if everything else fails, use heavy weapons. When you need to temporarily incapacitate Mr. X, heavy weapons like the shotgun or magnum can be effective. Aim for his head or weak spots to deal maximum damage and stun him briefly. Just make sure to stay calm and manage your resources. It's easy to panic when Mr. X is pursuing you, but staying calm and managing your resources is key. Use ammunition and healing items wisely, and don't waste them on unnecessary encounters with him. Remember, it's okay to die sometimes, it's a video game after all. Remember, Mr. X is persistent, but with careful planning, quick thinking, and resource management, you can overcome his challenge and progress through the game. Additionally, it can't be ignored just how good Mr. X's tracking skills are, with him stalking Leon and Ada throughout the entire game, going from the police station to the sewer to the Nest Laboratory. While he might have been eliminated by the same tried-and-true method of launching a rocket at his face, Mr. X is dangerous, intimidating, and overall interesting antagonist that helps turn the police station in Resident Evil 2 from an eerie crawl from room to room to a mad dash from the Tyrant as you attempt to solve puzzles. And with that being said, that is my analysis of Mr. X from Resident Evil 2. I hope you all enjoyed the video and learned something new. I'm not sure if I want to do more gaming or commentary videos, so leave a comment down below. Let me know, do you guys prefer like more gaming videos or more commentary-based videos? But with that being said, if you have stuck around this long, please like and subscribe because liking and subscribing helps out the channel personally and subscribing makes you feel good. I hope you all have a great day, drink some water, do something fun outside today, and stay cool.